speeding bullet. If you only knew the power of the dark side.
More powerful than a locomotive.
Hulk! Smash!
Able to leap tall buildings at a single bound.
There's more to them than meets the eye.
Been a long time coming, but the Evil Clown has returned to the airways to once again rot your minds here on Chuckles Crypt, Rhode Island Free Radio, and I am joined by the one and only George Garner and Norris Misery. We are here to talk all things nerdy, and this summer it is not failing to start off with all things nerdy. If you are a comic fan, or even a reading fan, or a Disney fan, this is the summer for you. If you did not watch Civil War, plug your ears now, because I'm going to give you a couple spoilers out there, and I don't feel bad, because I waited, I wasn't on the airwaves, gave you time, and it's been out for almost a month now, so I gave you the time, and I promise a review, and I will. If I had to give a star system, like an upside-down pentagram system, you know, that'd be like the star I'd give, I would definitely give this a 5 out of 5.
Wow.
This movie was incredible. There's no shortness of words for this. I don't know what Marvel's recipe is that they're doing different from DC's recipe for the movies. But movie-wise, Marvel is kicking DC's ass.
It's called a better pedigree. Marvel has always been a better house than DC in the four-color comics all the way up to CGI movies. And
they're doing it. And I am a DC mark. I totally am. I mean, I'm a Batman. I'm sporting a Flash shirt here. I love the DC universe.
The bulk of your comic collection is more on the DC heavy side.
And, of course, I got my favorite Marvel characters, and the Hulk is one of them. We're going to get to another one down the road on tonight's show. But that was incredible. I mean, they even took jobbers that I thought of as really, you know, they should have been in the Avengers, first of all.
Yeah.
When it started off, like Ant-Man and Black Panther and
Black Panther was amazing. Oh,
incredible. They captured that character
so well.
That actor did a fantastic job.
I don't think they could have handpicked a better actor to pull that character off.
Yeah, you know who blew me out of the water the most? The Falcon. And I don't like that character. He is definitely, in my mind, he's a jobber.
I'll tell you, now I haven't seen the movie yet, but it's my own fault, so don't worry about it. As you said, but as far as the Falcon, no, and I never did.
Yeah, and
Jobber, he's in between. He's in between. He's kind of
like B class.
Yeah, but not enjoyable. It's like he shows up in a story, and it's you say, you wait till he's gone.
In this movie. In this movie, he kicks ass. He's right up there, hanging tough with Iron Man. Like he is that much of an important character to the point where. He's right up there with the tops.
He's Captain America's right hand.
Yeah, so yeah. I mean, they did some really cool stuff with Ant-Man that I'm not going to spoil too much, that I was very excited to see them pull out.
Well, they gave the character a little bit more personality. As much as he wasn't in this movie for a great amount of time, his character developed a little bit better. You could be like, okay, I could stomach another Ant-Man movie because the first one was okay, not fabulous.
And oh my God, did they nail it.
Yeah.
Spider-Man was awesome. I mean, I am not... Everybody that's listening to the show that knows me knows that I am not a huge Spider-Man fan. When he's by himself, when he's in a group, okay, I can stomach him. When he was with the Avengers in this one, incredible job casting this actor.
Tony Stark so well.
Yeah, I didn't really care for the CGI'd bug suit. I mean, that I think was kind of unnecessary.
It was a nice design, though. It was aesthetically pleasing. You just didn't like that the eyes looked like they blink.
They did blink, and you don't need the CGI leotard on a superhero. That's really, really is lazy.
Yeah.
I mean, there's no reasoning for that.
But it takes a lot of effort, so it's lazy, but in a not lazy way.
Okay, and this is still a 5-star movie?
Oh, still. Okay. I mean, the action...
I don't know if I'd go 5, I'd go like 4.
Well, that's... Because you're Nurse Misery. We're not listening to
I'm
yours.
I'm a miserable witch.
Yeah.
I know.
I mean, it had some story to it. It did, to bring it up to where it was going. But when the action started, it was like that roller coaster. You had that slow climb and that downward spiral, and it was in your face the whole movie. And if you haven't watched Age of Ultron,
don't watch this.
Do not watch this is right, because this is kind of like a direct sequel to that.
Okay.
As much as it is Captain America.
There's important plot points.
It's more of an Avengers movie, and I don't realize.
That's the impression I got. Like, again, I haven't seen the movie itself, but that's the impression I got just from the common attractions and the promos, is that it's the new lineup of the Avengers.
Yeah, it's right? Not really just about Captain America. I don't know why they did that, called it Captain America Civil War. Yes, it was about how he divided the faction up.
So now there's a West Coast and East Coast. Blah,
yeah,
blah, blah.
But it was more or less the lower Avengers coming up and taking the place of the big ones. Because if you're all out there in the comic world, don't be disappointed, because the Hulk does not stick around in the Avengers.
But he's not supposed to. That's a good thing.
Neither does Thor.
Thor doesn't either. Those guys are big knocker guys that have their own books in the Marvel Universe, and they show up as needed. Otherwise, the group that you see on Civil War,
kind of what you got.
That is the Avengers. I mean, that's what you're going to get. And if you don't like those characters, you're not going to enjoy the next couple Avengers movies, because they are actually putting in the real Avengers now. I think enough of us geeks complained that.
For what? Minus Wasp.
Yeah, they still don't have Wasp in it yet.
They figure it's redundant with Black Widow, maybe?
No. Wasp is along the same lines as. But she was around with Pym. So I think that's one of the reasons they're not doing it, because they talked about her being an Ant-Man. And she got lost in the suit and everything. So I think that's their way of talking to her from not being in there.
True.
But I believe the new one, they're going to be having Ms. Marvel coming in. So,
which will be neat to see who they cast for that.
Yeah, that'll be an interesting to see what's going on with that. But bigger news coming up in, well, a couple of days. X-Men, Age of Apocalypse is around
Friday.
The corner.
I'm sure there's an early release Wednesday or
We
Thursday.
Will get to that in a second, but right now we're going to go down to some music here on Chuckle's Crypt, Rhode Island Free Radio. Some Guns N' Roses, Night Train.
Yeah!
Hey, I wonder if they were talking about the night train in Boston. Because riding that thing is epidemically it's scary.
It is to your health?
Yeah, that's definitely a night train to think about, all the stuff you would see there. True story, a couple, well, more than a couple years, more like a decade ago when I was a younger clown, I decided to visit Salem by myself, okay? And that's not the big thing. The big thing is I decided to do it in zombie gear. And I rode the train from Providence into the T station up in Boston and switched over to the one in Salem. And boy, you should have seen the looks. Not so much going, but coming back at 2 o'clock in the morning on the train. All the people thinking, am I really sitting next to a zombie right here?
Now, for all the How I Met Your Mother fans out there, have you ever been on the drunk train? I left New York City once, right about 1:30, 2 o'clock closing time, a.m. You know, after we Cretan 3 had played a gig, I was right. Coming back home to Providence. Everybody on the train was drunk, every single person. I'm thinking, oh, I'm going to get a nice nap on my way back to Providence. No, everybody on the train was wasted.
Puking everywhere, kicking your seat, talking about...
Partying.
Yeah, having
a
good old time.
Couples having sex, there has to be.
Talking about people that like to have a good time and everything, we're going to go into the X-Men. Now, it's not one of my favorite comic books. I'll tell you that right now. I think it's very kiddish. And I know you're saying, oh, comics are kiddish. But, no, I think the X-Men would definitely aim towards...
A younger crowd.
Especially with the cartoons in the 90s.
Love those.
Good cartoon. But unfortunately, it was competing with some tough cartoons that were out. You had the Ninja Turtles that they were competing with. Disney's animation stuff that was on the afternoon. And, of course, you had the Power Rangers later on. So that was a really tough crowd to compete with.
There were a lot of awesome cartoons in the 90s.
So, of course, it didn't stick around. There are many versions of the X-Men cartoon out there. If you guys ever want to check them out, some of them up on Netflix. And one of my favorite X-Men's Origins of Wolverine. Unfortunately, the way that they end it kind of pisses you off because they end it halfway through and they don't pick up the season again. So what you get is what you get. Now, as far as the books go, I'll go on record to say this. I'm a huge geek when it comes to the X-Men villains. There is nothing like the power of the X-Men villain universe. The heroes, on the other hand, may I say more than just Cyclops?
I thought you were going to go Jubilee.
Jubilee. And your favorite over there?
I liked Gambit.
Gambit, the guy that throws lit-up cards at people.
I liked him as a kid, but I liked magicians, and I'm like, ooh, he's doing card stuff. He's kind of like a really super powerful magician.
Those guys are awesome. Stupid. And I get so tired of hearing Cyclops cry and complain about Jean Grey. That you're waiting for for Wolverine to bitch slap him with the claws. Like, dude, get over it. I did your girlfriend. Your girlfriend doesn't like you anymore.
Get her better than you.
Yeah, but he's so whiny that you just want to choke him. And he becomes
he's teacher's pet, though.
He becomes one of the Atlases that starts up the whole Avengers versus X-Men thing. He starts a war between two factions. That's how much of a little whiny bitch he is.
Yeah, although that's not unusual that the villains outdo the good guys.
Oh, they do, too. I mean
but that's not unusual. I mean, if you really think of any, whether it's comics, whether it's film, whether...
Pro wrestling,
yeah. I mean, think about the bad guys. Think about the good guys. I mean, this holds true for... But I will agree with you, by the way, that X-Men was never my favorite comic. Just the characters themselves, just something was missing. I always preferred the Avengers. I always preferred even the Defenders. I mean, I just was not a big X-Men fan, so I agree with you there. But, I mean, think of everything from Star Wars to the Avengers. I mean, without the villain, you know.
What would Star Wars be without Darth Vader?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's very tough, or Spider-Man without the Green Goblin. Yeah. The Avengers without Loki.
Yeah.
I mean, you know what I'm saying? It's very hard to make good guys as interesting as the bad guys.
Yeah.
It's almost impossible.
It does happen. And,
it can. Yeah.
It does. A good portion of that. You could compare the Incredible Hulk. He's cool no matter what, even if he does have
He can be like almost that anti-hero style.
Yeah, the Hulk is almost a tweener, though.
Yeah, he is, but he's still not a supervillain.
He's not a supervillain, but he's not always a superhero. Sometimes the heroes have to fight him, so...
But he's still cool, nevertheless, on his own. Yeah. He doesn't need villains to carry him on. Whereas someone like the X-Men... Now, the original X-Men, Nurse Misery, do you know who they are?
I only remember from comics, so... I mean, the cartoon. So that's my base of memory.
George, do you remember them? The original?
No. Like I said, I gave them a try, and then I passed.
Wow, you've even stumped George Garner tonight.
Yeah. I had to pull it up myself because I didn't remember the originals because, like, Nurse Misery.
I would have some educated guesses, but...
I go by the cartoon because
I'm thinking Cyclops.
Yep, he's one
Beast,
of them.
I would assume.
Beast is one
the
of them.
Beast. Although, wasn't the Beast part of a group before the X-Men?
Could have been, but he's in this. He's
but,
part
but
of the
he's
original.
He's the
original
X-Men.
Yep.
What about Nightcrawler?
Nope.
Jean Grey?
Nope.
Storm?
Nope.
Okay,
Professor
I quit.
Xavier? Hey.
No, well, of course, Professor Xavier is...
I had to throw
is,
the obvious just because I'm like,
yeah. But
I
as
need
far
a point
as
here, I'm striking out.
Original X-Men, and I'm saying yellow and blue suit, Beast before he was even blue, he just looked like he looked like one of those...
He's kind of like a shaved gorilla.
No, he looked like a hobbit in a blue and yellow suit running around.
Yeah.
You had Angel or Archangel... Later on, he had the angel wings, and his father ripped them off.
And
he ends up getting
the
mechanical ones. And you had Iceman, kind of a ripoff of DC's rogue character there. I'm not going to mention. and then you have Marvel Girl, which...
Who's that?
Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm saying. But then you would get into the classic X-Men that we all know of.
Clearly Wolverine.
Yeah, Wolverine, Jean Grey, Cyclops, Beast, Nightcrawler, which I did like Nightcrawler. Nightcrawler is pretty badass. I don't think they've captured him right yet.
And they've done him justice here and there, but he could be done better in the movies.
Yeah, I don't
stuff.
Think he's been hit right yet. But there's a whole bunch of them, including Magneto, Once Upon a Time.
I forgot about that.
He was a good guy before he went to bad side. But as far as the villains go, incredible. One of my favorites coming out of the X-Men universe is Onslaught. If you don't know who Onslaught is, get the books, pick them up and read them. He is a figment of Professor
Xavier's
head. That tells you how powerful Professor X was and how he tried keeping...
His own inner demons.
Yeah, this stuff inside of him, because when this... Beast is released onto the Marvel Universe, he kills ruthlessly. Avengers, Fantastic Four, X-Men. It took a lot to tackle this guy down. And of course, we got the movie that's coming out Friday, mm-hmm. Age of Apocalypse. Apocalypse is a badass character. You guys are going to find out. Thank God they didn't go with the purple... monstrosity that they were showing when they first were doing the trailer to this, but he's a badass character. And then, if you know, we said it before, Magneto, the dude can control metal and the magnetism. The Earth runs off of magnetism.
Yeah. Now, and is this a spot since Magneto came up? Would I be amiss to say he's probably my favorite guy on the X-Men?
Oh, no.
He is. I mean, at least in the... Now, movies, we mentioned we're dealing with movies. I mean, the problem to me with the movies is I'm always rooting for Magneto because the scenario he lays out, you know, the humans hate what's different. Yeah. They want to kill the mutants.
He always has a valid point.
But it's true.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, so, and I have trouble even just, like, why would any of the mutants, seeing what human beings are like, why would they even fight Magneto?
Yeah.
In other words, you see, you know.
Magneto's like an extreme version of Martin Luther King. Like, he's like, I've had enough of what you're doing to my people.
You're
I'm going to fight back.
Right, and it's even more than Martin Luther King. It harkens back to the treatment of the Native Americans.
Right.
I mean, and that's the example. I mean, if you're a mutant, all you have to do is look at that.
Yeah.
And that's what's in your future. I mean, there's no way around it. You know, the humans can talk nice. They can. There is no way around it. There's going to be a showdown.
Yeah.
So that's what I can't. And I have a hard time.
Like, logically, how do they logically not want to be on
right,
his side?
Exactly. How would you, or at the very least, be neutral?
Yeah.
But not fight against them.
No. Like,
I mean, it makes no sense.
You would think there'd be the humans, the mutants, and then this neutral middle mixed of humans and mutants.
Yeah, those are the mutants and humans that have sex.
Yeah.
Seriously, that'd be the in-between.
Let me tell you something, too. A man that can control magnetism stops the rotation of the Earth.
We're
all dead. We're flying off and going into outer space and popping.
Yeah, but including him and his followers. So, I mean,
he's got enough stuff where he puts a bubble around him. It doesn't affect him.
Yeah, but destroy the whole world and then come out of your bubble. I mean,
your bubble's going to pop.
This is
eventually.
A man that took a full flipping island and with his powers was able to have it float in outer space just.
Yeah, he
and he still had
atmosphere
reserve powers to still kick your ass.
Right. So actually, the fight between them, well, except for the X-Men, the fight between the mutants and the humans should be a short one.
Yeah. It should be very short.
It really should.
Humanity shouldn't last.
I mean, even
long.
Wolverine learned a valuable lesson not to mess with him when he ripped out his antimanium out of his pores.
And even you still have metal in your blood, so you can still be controlled and tortured by this
man. And there's metal everywhere on this earth. There is not a place where you can't find it. The ocean, you know, freaking, it's part of the earth's elements, and it's all around us, especially with nowadays with modern technology. It's not too much to pull a satellite out of the atmosphere and drop it on your head.
Right. Now in the X-Men movies, they're not part of the Marvel Universe, correct?
They are not part of the Marvel Universe. And I tell you this, we'll talk about this in a second. Disney is biting it to pieces, and they want the X-Men series probably more than they want the Incredible Hulk series. But we'll get to that in a minute. We're going to go down to some tunes, some 3 Days Grace. And yes, when Magneto took that island up into space and had all his followers, misery does love company.
Of the past you left behind. I don't need your condescending words about me looking lonely. I don't need your arms to hold me, cause misery is waiting on me. I am not alone, not beaten down just yet. I am not afraid of the voices in my head. Down the darkest road, something follows me. Condescending words about me looking lonely. I don't need your arms to hold me, cause misery is waiting on me. I am not alone, not beaten down just yet. I am not afraid of the voices in my head. Down the darkest road, something follows me. We'll be right back.
Yeah, Nurse Misery does love company. That's why she keeps me locked up in the insane asylum, only to let me out once in a while to produce this great radio show that is on Rhode Island Free Radio. What is that great radio show again? It is Chuckle's Crypt. And coming up next, the Haunted Cabaret, all things haunted and evil, and a step into the darker side, as I would say it. We're tiptoeing on the lighter, cheerier side. But once we get into that Twilight Zone, oof, you guys better buckle in and be ready for that roller coaster ride, because someone's bound to puke. So we're here talking about the X-Men and how Disney really does want this franchise. They want, I believe Fox is the ones that owns them right now. They yeah. want them to let go of that eventually, which I don't think they're going to, because it is it is a heavy moneymaker for Fox, just like the Avengers are for Disney. They're not going to. They just got Spider-Man, and they're pretty happy with the rights to that and having to be able to put him in the film. But I can guarantee you that those greedy mouses with the upside-down Celtic symbols are putting their teeth to that proverbial vampire fruit and trying to suck everything out of the Marvel Universe so they can pinch every dime out of our wallets.
Yeah, but like I said, you know, during the music when we're off air, I mean, given, unless you want to reboot the X-Men series, given where the movie series and the character development and the story developments are right now with the Avengers, with Thor, Captain America, X-Men, and the whole thing, there is no plausible way to join up the X-Men and the Avengers, rather the rest of the Marvel Universe, after the fact.
I think they would just ignore it. I'll be honest with you.
Yeah, that's what they would probably do, and then I and other legions of people would hate it, and they wouldn't care exactly. because enough stupid people would
like it.
Would like
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
And say, oh, well, we'll ignore it too.
I mean, they ignored the first two Spider-Mans when they threw this kid in there. They didn't even make mention to any of that stuff. It's like, well, Spider-Man's been here. Boom, there you
and
go.
And they totally changed a lot of the plot points and stuff. But you know.
And that's what they would do with this. They would say, okay, yeah, the X-Men were in New York City, but while the Avengers were taking care of point A and B, the X-Men were over in the Savage Island taking care of point C and D with the dinosaurs. So it had no time to do with
by
that.
By all means, I mean, Marvel Comics, all through their history, they could bend and twist a storyline. You know, yes. I mean, you know,
but
I'm not saying Marvel Comics wasn't really good at that. You know, the only practical way, though, I mean, not to insult some of our nerdish intelligence, would be, well, DC has the answer with the multiverse.
Yep.
Exactly.
Now, if you're going to do anything, if you're going to be rapacious corporate money grubbers, just steal the multiverse.
Yeah, might as well.
Yeah.
Right, and it doesn't have to be the multiverse. It can just be an alternate reality.
Yeah.
You don't have to be multi about it. Just, right. They break through into another reality, another dimension.
You're missing Fantastic Four, too. And they're, when they did the Civil War story and they broke this out, if you guys are listening, spoiler alert, they're part of the comic books, the Fantastic Four, are part of the Civil War. And all the Civil War was basically, and I don't know why, okay, I do know why they called it Civil War, but all it was inside the Avengers. They didn't suck anybody else in from the Marvel Universe, which is what this was kind of missing. That's the only thing. Right. I don't think they should have called it Civil War. It should have been called, like, I don't know, something like War Within, because Civil War entired the whole Marvel Universe.
Right, it would imply everybody taking sides.
Yeah, and they were taking sides on this fight, and that is not what happened. And, of course, the X-Men, too. And that is one character that the Avengers are missing that I guarantee you, if you added this guy in there, the seats, you would not be able to keep them empty. And, yes, I am talking about Wolverine. He is an Avenger, and he is one of those characters in the Marvel Universe where he fits wherever the hell
he wants to.
He is the one and only X-Men that I really like. And that's the only thing that kept it tolerable for me for the X-Men itself was him and his quirky one-liners. But I appreciated him a lot more when he was on his own doing his own movies and stuff than versus with.
Yeah, I don't know what the general opinion was, but I did too. I thought the movie The Wolverine was. I thought that was superior.
Yeah, X-Men and X-Men 2, I really didn't like. I tell you this right now, as far as movies go, they didn't catch me. I didn't find them entertaining at all. And then we got into X-Men The Last Stand, which the entertainment started to pick up for me. I enjoyed the third one. X-Men Origins of Wolverine, I really liked that one.
Yeah.
X-Men First Class, really decent flick. And, of course, you had The Wolverine, which was 2013. Didn't really like the way that they did the samurai. And then you had X-Men's Days of Future Past, which was a really good flick. I don't know why they're adding Deadpool in this list of the X-Men. Probably because he just... Oh, wait, Colossus is in it. And there is a jobber in there. That's all I'm going to leave it. Some nuclear whatever her name is.
Yeah, like teenage something nuclear whatever. It was... I had to look at you and say, is that a real superhero name? Because that's terrible.
It was bad.
So terrible, I can't even remember it.
Question, Chuckles. Before we get off the subject of crossing over and joining X-Men up with... In the Marvel four-color comics of yesteryear, now, for a while, if I'm not mistaken, the Fantastic Four, the Avengers, the X-Men, all inhabited... They didn't cross over, right? They were all inhabiting their own universe.
Yeah.
In the Marvel comics. At what point did they start crossing over? Was that like it was as late as the 70s, wasn't it?
That's a good question. That's something I would have to look up because it's not really something I was concentrating on.
But it is a good question because
they all had different writers and different story backgrounds, and eventually they crossed.
I think the only way it would work is do the parallel universe thing, and the best part about that is you can pick and choose.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, we don't have to bring all the Jabba's nerds.
Yeah, leave Gibbon and Jubilee back. I mean, come on. The girl launches fireworks at someone. I'm like, yeah, that's impressive. That's entertaining. Not going to hurt me. I mean, it might give me a little burn and flash my eyes, but in the world of Marvel villains, you're throwing firecrackers at the juggernaut.
Yeah, that's going to be successful.
No, he's going to smush you into the ground. You're throwing fireworks at, like, some of these villains that, like, one of my favorites, Omega Red. What are you going to do to him throwing flashcards at him?
She had to be bait. What? She always had to
even
be bait.
Even Gambit.
Look over here. Look over here. I sparkle.
I'm a vampire. Louisiana thief. Okay, I see where the girls get the enthused. He's a bad boy. He throws lit cards at people. But the Joker can light a card on fire and throw it at someone, too. Doesn't mean he's awesome.
Well, I liked the Joker and Gambit when I was a kid, so
Speaking of lame female superheroes, wasn't there a woman called Halo or something like that?
There probably was.
She created rainbows and holograms. And
there was some weird ass.
I think it came out during the late 70s or 80s disco era.
I wouldn't
that
doubt it.
Very 70s.
We'll have to look that up during a break to see
Marvel
this character.
Marvel hit some dregs, believe me. And I agree with you. I have no desire to see these people again. I really don't.
I mean, Rogue, okay, she's cool. I mean, this girl can, like, she can take your powers.
She touches you and she's got your powers.
She can womp your ass. Storm, okay, that's a cool character. She can play with the elements and everything. That always makes a little entertaining. An emo guy that shoots a laser beam out of his eyes, and I wasn't into. Frasier playing Beast in the movie.
That was amazing.
That was pretty cool. I mean, that was a different cast of the characters to play him. The younger kid that I think is playing him now does a better job.
But for the time, he played the character well and owned it as an older version.
Beast is just like a super strong gorilla that's blue.
Yeah,
and
actually,
he's smart.
Nurse Mizzy, at some point before we leave here tonight, check up on the Beast. Let's get a history.
Okay.
Because I remember in the dregs of my mind that the Beast, he was part of a group from like maybe the early 70s, late 60s, early 70s.
That explains the haircut.
Yeah,
exactly.
So we're going to find that out. We're going down to a song here on Chuckles Cripper Island Free Radio, and we'll come back and we'll get some people's around the table, their favorite X-Men and villains. I mean, that's some cool. Maybe we'll even We'll include our producer over here, Mr. Tony Jones,
because
he is, if he stops crapping his pants on air. So let's go down to some Alice Cooper. We are a bunch of sick things around here.
Sick things in cars rotate round my stars. Sick things, my things, my pets, my things. I love you things. I see as much as you.
Now, we don't have much time. Unfortunately, we're getting down to the last 10 minutes of the show. So we're going to quickly go around. And then we have a couple events up and coming that we need to talk to you about. And stick around because the Haunted Cabaret is coming up next here on Rhode Island Free Radio. The best 2 hours that you will find anywhere in the broadcast
universe.
Guaranteed. Even if I am talking bullshit, I am a definitely talented bullshit talker. That's why I'm an evil clown. Now, we're talking all things X-Men, and yes, the Age of Apocalypse is coming up. And I said this at the break, damn you, movie theaters, you're going to be getting twice my pay because, unfortunately, it comes out the same day as Alice in Wonderland.
And triple your pay if you decide to buy a cup of soda.
Yeah. So I got to appease the pregnant wife and watch Alice in Wonderland, but that does not mean I am not going to stick around and see X-Men because I'm not going to wait till the next day for one of you little assholes to ruin it up on Facebook and tell me the whole story.
Spoiler alert.
Or on the radio through 94BJY.
Well, like I say, just use the old goner approach to seeing these movies. You pay one price, you go in there for the first show, and then...
We don't say anything else about what you're going to do right now because then they'll know my plan and they will stop me because those kids are listening right now.
Oh, the kids don't care.
Yeah, well, they might. They might be one of those kids that wants to get up and come in and become a boss. You never know.
I want to run the popcorn machine.
I want a promotion.
Yeah, so I could get...
butter your popcorn.
I want to make $10.15 an hour.
Now, we are all things comic books, and you guys out there are saying, what are some of the best X-Men comics you've read? And hands down for me, anytime the X-Men end up in Savage Island... I'm really excited because you have X-Men and you have dinosaurs. Eventually, Wolverine's going to be stabbing some T-Rex in the throat with his claws, and Storm's going to be getting chased by Sauron. Sauron, if you haven't mentioned, I said the villains were the best. He is one of my favorite. He's a pterodactyl that can mind control you. He's a pretty cool villain, and he's not a bird brain. He's smarter than a lot of other villains out there. I really like him. And I'm hoping somewhere down the road they introduce him into the X-Men movie series, along with one of my all-time favorites, and this is where we're starting. When you go villain-wise, I have to stop from the start and give you a couple because I can't give you just one. Omega Red, badass villain. And when it takes a point where a man by the name of Colossus has to hold you there so you could be frozen because there's no other way of defeating you, that's pretty cool. Of course, we talked about it. Magneto, really cool. I said Sauron. And yes, I'm going to do the last two, of course, being Mr. Apocalypse, because we're going into the Age of Apocalypse, and Onslaught. Now, if you go as far as heroes, I only have one in the X-Men universe that's my favorite, and that is Wolverine, because he's one of my favorite Marvel characters, even if he wasn't in the X-Men. The dude's badass. There's just no way around him. I mean, he gets ripped in half by the Incredible Hulk. One half of his torso is thrown across the world, and the other half is thrown across the opposite side of the world, and he still survives it. I mean, that's pretty cool. So, yes, Age of Apocalypse, I will be watching it after I watch Alice in Wonderland, so it's going to be a long day of me drinking Mountain Dew and visiting the movie urinals.
Yes.
So, Nurse Misery, what are some of your favorite X-Men villains and heroes? And please, please don't be stereotypical.
Well, you've already busted my balls for it. So, I do like Gambit. He was one of my favorites as a kid.
Montreal.
I enjoyed him. And Rogue was probably my, like, the female counterpart where I thought she was entertaining and enjoyed her. From the villains, I'm trying to remember the names. Like, clearly you don't want, like, the classics. Like, of course Magneto's amazing and totally badass.
Why can't you have the classic? If you like Magneto, you like Magneto.
Well, you just said don't pick the usuals.
No, I did not say that. I said don't be stereotypical. I thought you were going to go all female crew on me.
No.
But no, you didn't.
No.
But no, you can still pick Magneto if you think he's badass.
Yeah, I always enjoyed him. And I can't remember the other person I like offhand because my brain is kind of fried.
Pregnancy brain.
It's
worse
failing me
than pot brain.
It
ladies
is.
And gentlemen.
Oh my God, it's terrible. I feel...
So we're going to skip over you for the villain otherwise.
Yes.
Go right to George Garner because
okay,
he has valuable information for us.
Well, not so much valuable information, but maybe a little slightly askew insight. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, Magneto is my answer to both because in the X-Men universe, I don't see him as the bad guy.
And he's not sometimes.
This is right. He is the Martin Luther King. He is the Sitting Bull, the Geronimo of the mutants.
Yeah.
He is the Thomas door.
He's the only
of the X-Men universe. You guys don't even know what Thomas Door is.
If anybody out there listening gets that reference, contact the station and you get a prize.
We have Narragansett yeah. in the refrigerator.
And don't look it up on Google either. So it goes with, and I said I was going to go to our producer, and yes, Mr. Jones is a nerd, and he grew up in the X-Men universe watching the cartoons. So, Tony, I hate to like put a point in your Lieutenant Governor's ranking, but maybe this would help you next time. What is your favorite X-Men and X-Men villain?
Well, I have to go with Magneto also. But by the way, I cannot believe you're not a fan of Negasonic Teenage Warhead. I mean, come on.
Oh, that was her name.
She
Thank you for
sucked.
Looking that up.
Teenage Warhead?
Yeah.
She was horrible. And like to, before we go into these things, by the way, everybody said, watch Deadpool. You're going to love it. I did not. I did not.
You know,
love
I can
it.
See
it
how it appeals to the millennial generation, though,
right.
character wise.
Yeah. But as far as villain wise, those guys were stupid. Yeah. There was no one. They were. I didn't even care.
They were
who
putties.
They was fighting. Yeah. And then the whole like, okay, come on, why the origin story?
It was like
I
a
don't
love story.
Give a why a living truck about the origin stories of Deadpool. If I want to know about it, I will go get the damn book. And read it. They were doing so well with how they started, and then they had to go back to the flipping origins crap. Not necessary.
It sounds like they made that movie. It was supposed to be like a superhero movie for those people who don't care for superhero
right.
movies.
Yeah, they were trying to bring in a new generation.
Right.
But for my good guy, you guys are very talked him to death, but it would have to be Beast just for the fact that he thought he was getting out of it. He thought he was going to go back to normal, not have to be a mutant anymore. And how did that work out?
Not so well.
It worked out in his favor. Things
hanging
always
upside,
got a little worse.
Upside down for the war room or the chemistry room, trying to keep his inner emo in and just say the hell of it. I'm a mutant. So Nurse Misery, we got about 3 minutes left. And
let me
what's
ramble
coming
these
up?
Off pretty quick. So our next event is going to be a parade. We will be at the Gatsby Day Parade, which is going to be in the Narragansett Parkway, Warwick, Cranston area, June 11th.
Which, by the way, kudos to you guys on that. For anybody out there who doesn't know, that's not a parade where you just sign up and you're in it. It takes a little bit of finesse to get into that event.
You need to apply. And
like
you need
years
to,
in advance.
And we got lucky. I mean, the parade committee chairperson, she was wonderful and very sweet to us.
Now there's a different parade that happens in Providence, and you guys can just show up and get right into that.
Oh, I'm sure there's plenty of Providence parades we can just create on our own.
One of these days we have to do that Pride parade. I have no problem with that. I think we have to. It's just there's too much stuff conflicting with that.
I think it just hasn't worked in our schedule, and that's the only reason we haven't been able to make that a priority in the past. But after the Gatsby Day Parade, which will be June 11th, we will be attending the New England Quahog Festival's event, which is going to be June 25th. And there's going to be a sea creature parade to kick off that event. And you will see
that
Chuckles
is,
and crew and some...
That is epic. But yes. Even more epicness is Johnny and the Earthquakes are going to be playing there. That is flipping phenomenal.
All the way from Manchester, New Hampshire.
Exactly. So if you don't want to just see Chuckles in a shark suit and me very pregnant in a mermaid costume, which is a little comical in and of itself.
Now, they may never let me do anything in Whitford again after you guys and Johnny Earthquake show up, but...
But
you
that's
know, we'll
okay.
Especially when they see Johnny and I hugging, they're going to be like, they're in cahoots.
I may be run out of town on a rail after that.
Yeah,
there's room in Connecticut.
Hometown may not love you so much after that, Tony. After that, we will have a third parade. Yes, folks, three parades this summer. We are going to be walking our little clown butt skinny this year. We will be in the Ancient and Horribles Parade, which is going to be July 4th. Which is a Monday, up in the Gloucester, Rhode Island area. It's going to be at start off at the Chepachet Union Church and go on down through the Chepachet area.
And that's where I historically shook Governor
and
Chafee's
almost
hand.
President Chafee.
Yep. And
yes.
I watched as Governor Chafee got splatted right in the face with a water balloon.
Yes,
and everybody
we were directly behind him, and I was afraid they were going to blame you.
And everybody gives that man shit. and all he does that deserve like a champ. It. That kid could have been that kid could have been arrested for assaulting a political figure.
He got nailed pretty good, and he just shook it off, smiled and waved, and like, "Wow, kudos to you."
Who else would have done that? They would have had that kid in the ground, curb stomping his face on the sidewalk.
And he was just like, "Eh, whatever. So, I was hot anyways."
Yes, Governor Chafee, not the brightest man, but he's got a good sense of humor.
Kudos to you for taking it like a champ, sir. Our next event to help close out our summer's festivities will be Ocean State Paracon, which is going to be in July, which is a two-dayer, July 16th and 17th at the Assembly Theater in Harrisville, Rhode Island. This year, their charity of choice is going to be the Coalition for Rhode Island Against Domestic Violence. So it's a great charity. They have huge raffles. They have a lot of celebrities coming down, especially in the paranormal field. And lo and behold, our dear Chuckles the Clown is on their celebrity list this year, thanks to Ken DaCosta.
All right, boys and ghouls, since we're going to wrap things up, we're going to go down for some Young Guns bones very shortly, and then we will be back for the Haunted Cabaret, where this roller coaster ride is about to get flipping scary.
Listen to the sound of footsteps in the dark, to voices that may not be quite human, to the sound of screams in the night. The Haunted Cabaret, the home of all things horror, on Rhode Island FreeRadio.org, with your host, George Garner. The Haunted Cabaret starts now.
Live at the 7-Eleven. I'm trying to play this guitar.
That was Lost in America, the one and only Alice Cooper, kicking off this week's Haunted Cabaret in grand style. I'm your host, George Garner. Across the table from me, he has returned, Chuckles the Evil Clown.
Ghoul evening.
Along with Nurse Misery, behind the console, Tony Jones. And all that's left for me is to start talking about something horrible. And I'll tell you, I'm overwhelmed with choices. I really am.
There's a plethora for you to choose from.
Yeah,
we're currently living in what they call a content-rich environment.
Yes, we are. I mean, I can go, from bathrooms. I can go to any strata in the country, right? I can
Pretty
go
much.
From the lowest, which is the humble bathroom. I can go all the way to the White House. We can go actually underground, where some of our favorite themes are buried. Chuckles, got me thinking about comic books in the show that we just concluded, The Crypt. I don't know. I'll just touch on a couple of things really quick. First of all, bathroom wars. If there is anything even though we're FCC, I can say I don't give a shit about, right? If there's anything in this world I don't care about, it's where people go to the bathroom. I don't have a poop fetish.
No.
I don't like golden showers. If you do, that's fine. I can hear Donald Trump saying this. If you do.
You do.
But, so I don't care. But apparently.
A lot of people do.
A lot of people do, including the moronic, imbecilic idiot in the White House.
Now, there's three bathrooms I care about. The first bathrooms are the bathrooms at some of the dive bars that we play at because they're
very
filthy.
Important.
Yeah,
right.
never touch those seats.
I care about airport bathrooms or airplane bathrooms because I almost got stuck in one once. Literally, I couldn't get back out the door.
Terrifying.
Okay.
And the third one I care about is a place we used to frequent late night, Bickford's, which had a glory hole in it.
Yoo-hoo!
And if you were sitting in the bathroom relieving yourself, chances are a male genitalia would come shooting at your face through that glory hole,
terrifying.
Whether you wanted it or not, and I did not.
Well, didn't a hand come creeping under the stall toward you at, Club Decadence one night, too?
And
Tony Jones has been attacked by portions of the male anatomy in many a bathroom. And this just goes to prove my point, though. Tony, you really don't give a damn
there
about
no
this
law.
Whole thing either, do you?
Well, the thing is at Bickford's, they would seal up the glory hole, and then someone would just bust it back open the weekend after.
Right, the first direction would just push right through it. But here's the thing. They asked, this whole bi, gay, transsexual, I mean, the kids that these adults are supposed to be protecting, they don't care. And we know this because they took a big, gigantic survey of high school kids and junior high school kids, and the answer was, we don't care.
The question to me isn't, do you identify as a transvestite? The question to me is, did you have Taco Bell for lunch?
Exactly.
Yes.
How
that
bad
was
will this smell?
Right. That was always the biggest crisis. When you took a break from class to run to the bathroom. You knew you'd be in trouble if you waited outside that door long enough for that hideous stench to disperse that was in that bathroom. I mean, yes, that's a menace confined to the bathroom. Worry about that. I think instead of worrying about men going in ladies' rooms and ladies going in men's rooms, why don't we just have better fumigation of bathrooms?
Yeah.
Why don't...
Invest in air fresheners versus new signs.
Why don't we stop worrying about that and start worrying about the fact that we're dumping our crap into the waters we swim in?
Yeah, why don't we worry about that?
I mean, that's a little more important than who's going where. It's where you're putting this.
Ew. Yeah, I mean, I know. Last time I went swimming, and now granted, I went in the ocean, and now granted, it wasn't at one of the finer beaches. It was at Coney Island in New York.
Oh, jeez.
Okay. Oh, my.
Good God.
I waded into the water, and I was enjoying the summer sun, and, the oil tankers are going back
and
forth.
You're a brave man.
Well, I didn't dive in head first.
Okay.
I just went up to just below my genitals. Speaking of... A
dead body floated by.
Keeping things safe.
Well, yeah, because I...
Jimmy Hoffa.
Well, no, I just had this image of something from maybe like Godzilla versus the Smog Monster or the Green Slime or something. Mm. Some kind of like worm-like creature crawling into the hole in my penis.
That's why you stay out of the Nile River.
Yes, I am never going to a third world country and bathe in public waters. I am not.
No, that's not safe.
Right. But since when they passed a law, apparently coming right from the powers that be in Washington, D.C., saying that this decision about where you're going to take a dump was equal with the struggle of black people for civil rights.
Are you serious?
I'm serious.
That's so insulting to...
It is. And the great part of it is we have a black president saying this. Now, I don't know what water he was drinking.
The struggles of his people mattered less than where you take a shit.
Yeah, where you hang your...
No, it's equal.
It's equal. Yeah, it's equal. Basically, what he's... You know what I think? Maybe. Remember when he did that... press conference in Flint, Michigan, where they had the polluted water.
Yeah.
To prove a point, he drank a glass of that water.
Oh, so he's got some worm in his brain.
Yeah, I think he's got some worm in his brain of that Flint, Michigan press conference. There's no explanation.
So he's just never been the same since Michigan.
Our black president basically compared black people to male dicks.
That's so wrong.
Yeah,
Do you think they worried about this?
Just for the record, even Chuckles is grimacing. He has a
Do you think they worried about this back in the 1800s? You think Grant was like, maybe we should make sure that the heterosexuals and the homosexuals can use the same outhouse?
No, because they were wearing petticoats and, you know, five-piece suits. I mean, if you had to go to the bathroom, it took you 20 minutes to get all that clothes off.
Right, but I think the point Chuckles is making is that General Grant say, we're going to interrupt this war against slavery.
Yeah.
You know, so that we can assure people that they will safely be able to go to the bathroom in the outhouse, you know, where there's usually three circles anyway. So
I really sometimes I wish this was 990. I could left that F-bomb slip with the dollar because this is really incredibly stupid.
Yeah, I mean, this privacy in bathrooms didn't even begin until the 20th century, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, right? I think there's bathrooms up in the mountains now in some of the rural areas that they still have three holes in an outhouse, right?
Have you been to the Washington County Fair lately? I mean, your option there is a trough.
yeah, harkening back to the old days.
And some people poop in it. While you're peeing, you see a log go down there.
Ew.
Well, foreseeing or honoring the log cutters up in Maine that sent their logs bravely down the river.
Then they have the gall to ask for a donation while you're on your way out.
You will see more logs if you do not donate next season. That's worth it. I always throw a buck in that bucket. But no, then on top of it, then after this big fuss about equating the struggle of black people for civil rights with guys having the right to go into, and by the way, they don't emphasize both ways, right?
It's
not women going into men's rooms. It's the right of men to go into ladies' rooms.
But women can be sexual predators as well. So why is that not an issue?
That's true. It makes you wonder, right? Because now we have a male president. We have all these people on the left, that's the Democrats or whatever they are. Right? It's all fighting for the right of men to go unobstructed and unquestioned into the ladies' room. Here's the thing. And apparently, according to this law, like I was talking to Tony Jones before the show, just as it's illegal or it's against the rules to ask somebody what their religion is in this country. In other words, if let's say you're working for a company and you say you want a day off from work and you call somebody, the boss, and say, hey, listen, it's the Jewish holiday or it's Ramadan or it's Christmas. Mm-hmm. I want the day off. He can't say, well, what the hell? Since when are you Muslim or since when are you Christian? Or
exactly.
They're not allowed to say that.
Right. Whatever religion you claim you are, in the eyes of the law, you are.
You're it at that moment. Mm-hmm. Now, they're trying to do the same thing with this gender thing. What that means is, and I can't wait to do it myself.
You're going to grow like full beard out and say I'm a woman walking the ladies'
room? Are you kidding me? No. Well, first of all, this means, and now, not so long ago, I was a 16-year-old horny guy, okay, who would have loved to see the inside of the girls' locker room in high school, mm-hmm. right, without, you know, a teacher saying, where the hell are you going, you asshole, and... You know, sending you down outside.
Having free roam.
Right. Nowadays, if you interpret this law, right, the way it's said, a 16-year-old heterosexual boy can wander into the girls' room for a look around, and when he's asked, what the hell are you doing here, get out, he can refuse on the grounds that he's exploring his feminine side today. That's the practical consequence of.
Like I think it's time to get a job at one of the local colleges.
Well, actually, I don't want to work there. But I'll tell you one thing. When I went to Rhode Island College, I dated this girl that was. She lived in the Thorpe dormitory. I mean, I no longer go out with that girl, but I wouldn't mind a return visit one of these days. So I think rather than being the age I am, and so on and so forth, and the male sex, I think, you know, just for giggles and kicks, I'm just going to be a 18-year-old woman. You know, maybe next week when I have nothing better to do, and I'm just going to go into the Thorpe dormitory and just kind of lay down on the bed like I belong there. And when they say, "What the hell are you doing in here?" I'm going to say, "What? I'm an 18-year-old female college student."
That's going, what going I to, identify
yes,
as today.
18-year-old female college student. That's what I identify as today. I'm between classes, and I'm just reclining out in this bed waiting for my lesbian girlfriend to come out of the shower.
So they can't touch with that.
And by the way, and as far as our listeners overseas, if you think that I'm making this up, if you think that this is just a twisted, meandering wish fulfillment from the corners of my brain, no. This is courtesy of our president.
Thank you,
the
U.S. government.
The American government, a bunch of lawyers, mm-hmm. and Donald Trump is not even involved in this.
There's some people,
for once, you would expect him to be in this.
There's some people listening to this show overseas that would just be happy to have indoor plumbing. And here we are battling it out about who can use what bathroom.
Exactly.
And I guarantee you they're sitting there trying to think out, what are the horrors of this? This is supposed to be the Haunted Cabaret. Well, the horrors are the people that are going to be sexually assaulted in these bathrooms.
Yeah, I mean, I think most of our listeners, at least the ones overseas, not necessarily Americans, or we wouldn't be in this stupid situation.
Yeah.
I think most of our listeners are smart enough to realize the implications, the horrible implications of what I'm discussing. But Chuckles, yeah, if you want to spell it out, go right ahead.
It's going to happen. I mean, they're just writing it, and they're saying it's okay. They're saying, well, all that kid had to say is I was exploring my feminine side, and it was okay for me to go in there and do what I had to do.
Yeah.
You know? And there's lines of stuff you shouldn't cross, and reasons stuff is put some places.
There's a double entendre if I've ever heard one.
You know, and I hate to say it, if I walked into a woman's bathroom, I probably wear more makeup than half those women inside there. And if I said I was exploring my feminine side, I would still get shot.
But if you walked in there with a raging boner, then clearly you're not exploring your feminine side. You're just a horny guy trying to take a peek. And now, how do you differentiate the two?
But on the plus side, Chuckles, the same president that's trying to get men in the ladies' room for some reason is also trying to ban guns. So you would be safe, and the woman wouldn't be able to protect themselves.
Now, yeah, Chuckles, Nurse Misery, possibly George, you coming up in the hospitality business, mm-hmm. I've had to clean a bathroom or two.
Right.
And one thing I've learned on the filth level is that the women's bathroom is more filthy, disgusting than the men's bathroom, especially in restaurants.
Oh, it's scary.
Oh, it can be, yes.
How do you stick those tampons to the ceiling like
that? Why is that on the ceiling?
Why? Why?
What do they use, like a tampon slingshot?
I don't know.
You can't eject them pretty quick.
But the gross thing is, as you're trying to like scrape this off the ceiling, you hope it doesn't drop down in your face or into your mouth or any residue from this. And then, of course, you're changing the trash, and then there's three of them crusted to the bottom of the trash can. It's like, how did you go through the damn trash bag and put these here?
If only we had the song Ooh, That Smell queued up right now.
I mean, that's the horror of everything, ladies and gentlemen, is the ladies' bathroom.
I'll tell you, not too bad, though, for a segue. What we do have up next on the
And it's 4 minutes long, so I have some time to go throw up.
This is Great American Stupid by Desk here on the Haunted Cabaret on Rhode Island Free Radio.
Yeah.
All right. That was Great American Stupid by Desk. And this is the Haunted Cabaret. And yeah, Chuckles, at the end of that last segment, I think you did a really good job of pointing out how horrible, you know, the implications of the situation we're in could be. So thank you for that. The other thing you did is, you know, during your show, you got talking about X-Men. And by the way, everyone, you want to go listen to that show. But, you know, we talked about X-Men and comic villains, and it got me thinking about comic books.
You got excited about the villain stuff. I know you did.
Yeah, I did.
You're a villain rooter just like I am.
I did. I am, and I was, and I am still. But what I started thinking about, you know, okay, topics for the Haunted Cabaret. And so what I did in the cobwebbed corner of my brain is I cross-referenced comics, horror, and characters. So what I started to remember was back when I I still enjoy. Used to because I've got so many other interests now.
Yeah, you don't get as lost in
I
the story
don't
line.
Have time to get as lost in them as I used to. But
don't worry, when you get married, that time will come back.
Because she won't let me do anything else.
Right. You're going to be having, like me, your own secret stash in the closet.
That's not very secret. I bought you most of those.
Oh, I don't think that the stash has to be secret. I mean, I think anything that keeps you home.
Yeah. Yeah, you can have your own.
You can have your comic books. You can have your television. You can have your laptop. You can have your smartphone. You can have your desktop. You can... the key word is...
is the Undertaker comic book, or even worse than that, the Mankind comic book.
A carryover from fond old school days. Yep, I did it myself. I had a skill of, I could balance, I would have the math book on my desk, and then I would sit back in my chair far enough away so that I could balance a Cthulhu Mythos Lovecraft book or comic book, you know, House of Mystery comic, you know, with I remember one with an adaptation of Shambler from the Stars in it. But anyway, yeah, that's what would be on my lap at the same time as the math book was on my desk. So, yeah. I didn't have the comic in the book. I used the old, comic in the lap, book on the desk routine to get around with that.
You're a little more elaborate with it then.
Yeah, but of course the teacher knew what I was doing, but it was like a live and let live thing.
Yeah, you weren't disrupting her class.
Right, I didn't say much because I was reading the comic.
Yep.
And as long as I got good grades,
you weren't hurting anything.
Right, and which was great because there's always a girl in the classroom that rats on everybody.
Yeah.
Well, she ratted on me once about, he's reading the ham.
Dawn Davenport's eating a ham sandwich.
Exactly, and it was great because the teacher just said to it, yeah, but, George, he gets good grades.
Yeah.
What about, it was implied, what about you?
Yeah, what's your excuse? Stop paying attention to Jordan.
Meanwhile,
paying attention to class.
That person that ratted on you is a crack whore with 8 babies.
Either that or she's in the government trying to make us go to the wrong bathroom.
She's living on the highest of the high rise.
Probably. But yeah, but as far as horror comics, like characters from horror comics or horror comic characters, I guess depends how you want to put it. The ones that came to mind for me, now this is like Four Color Comics from back in the 70s, which I think was the heyday of Marvel Comics. I still enjoy the 80s, but I think the 70s. And the ones I remembered most were Werewolf by Night, which Nurse Misery, you mentioned in reference to the Beast.
Yes.
And when you said they made the Beast more werewolf-like to resemble Werewolf by Night. Werewolf by Night is and was the gold standard by which werewolf comics will be measured.
Oh, didn't
I mean,
know
I
that.
It didn't last long, but while it did, I mean, where else can you see a story about a werewolf who fights a demon that's possessed a rabbit?
Okay, that's intriguing.
It is. And naturally, the demon gets tired of being in possession of this rabbit and, goes looking for, bigger things to possess. So basically, the battle between the werewolf and the demon, escalates as the demon possesses better and better things to fight with. And then the other one is, Tomb of Dracula. Chuckles, you might remember that one.
Yep, good books.
That one, Yeah, that one, it's kind of like Dracula himself. Like, the series runs for a while, dies down, dies away, then it's revived. So, yeah, I don't think Dracula's never completely been absent from comics, right?
Just no.
Keeps coming back.
One way, shape, or form, he ends up in it. The newest one that he's in is Agents of Howl, which is S.H.I.E.L.D.'s supernatural team of baddie good guys. I mean, it's weird, but it's
entertaining.
It's a very good book.
Right. Now, here's one that I think only the most horror nerdy of comic aficionados would probably remember. Anyone out there remember a comic called Son of Satan? Even the clown is shaking his head no. That impresses me. I was right. But yeah, early 70s, it came on the heels of the Rosemary's Baby Exorcist boom of horror. And Son of Satan is literally about the son of Satan, you know, a guy that with a cape and tights and a pentagram on his chest instead of an S. And he carries a trident and he fights. He has revolted against his father and fights the forces of evil.
That's, you know, and intriguing.
Satan is always trying to bring his wayward son back into the fold.
Kind of like
good.
Lucifer right now.
Yeah.
Think that's where probably Lucifer probably got its idea.
Possibly. It could just be a coincidence because the idea is, you know.
Was this a DC comic?
No. This was Marvel.
Okay, because DC has this one called Lucifer where it's similar. The devil son escapes, or the devil escapes from hell, and they're trying to get him to come back down.
Yeah, but I don't think in that comic the son of Satan ever fought Adam, the first man.
Yeah,
No. but he is fighting archangels and demons.
Not bad.
And he's playing the good guy. Good guy-ish.
Yeah. Good-ish with a bad flair.
Well, yeah, but if anyone's ever wandering around in one of those comic book shops we love so much, ask the proprietor for back issues of Son of Satan. We're talking about the 1971, 1973, and that I'm not sure the exact year anymore, but it's right in that time period right there. So, yeah, one of my all-time favorites. Then, of course, over on the DC side, I mean, they didn't do as well, but they did all right. Well, if you include Swamp Thing as a horror comic, then, yeah, they did really good. Bernie Wrightson started off the original Swamp Thing. That was awesome. I mean, I even remember individual stories like Curse of the Raven Wind Witches, one of the all-time great comic horror stories, the original Bernie Wrightson Swamp Thing. And then you had another one called The Demon, just The Demon.
Yep.
And he's another one, I think, Chuckles. He comes and goes, you know, every so often he resurfaces. All right, but yeah, he originally came about, I think, in 1970, end of 1971 or 1972. But yeah, like he keeps just like Dracula, he's never quite dead.
Always looks like back. I'm looking at a reboot of Son of Satan. This looks like a very,
oh, really?
Very modern color storm of him. Doesn't look like the one you're talking about. It's very Photoshop looking.
I was having the same problem finding it.
Yeah, that would be a reboot.
Yeah, it looks like they did bring it. I'm seeing the original one now.
I can find it on eBay.
1973
was
when it first came out.
I was close, 1973.
The first appearance, Ghost Rider. That would, I'm not a big Ghost Rider fan, so that's probably why it would turn me off.
Me neither. That's not where I came across him, though. I didn't come across him until he had his own magazine.
Which was December of 75.
Which was Son of Satan, right?
And he was in S.H.I.E.L.D.'s Paranormal Containment Unit, so otherwise Agents of Howl. And he was in Midnight Suns, Masters of Evil, Hellfire Club, God Squad, and the Defenders.
But if you're looking to see how it all started, yeah, check out those original, you know, and like I say, not so much the Ghost Rider issues, because like Chuckles, I'm not a big Ghost Rider fan, but, you know, when he got his own, what do you say, 1975, he got his own
December
magazine?
December of 75.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, check that out. Right, in the meantime, let's get back to the music. How about some Gamora? Let's go with the Inner Turmoil here on the which we have no shortage of here on the Haunted Cabaret on Rhode Island Free Radio.
Things I can't hear, don't know, son, familiar.
Was Gamora, Inner Turmoil. As I say, you know, a condition prevalent here at the Haunted Cabaret, as it seems to be throughout the country, throughout the world these days.
Which, by the way, that's a local metal band. If you have a chance to check them out live, the guy, the lead singer, his name escapes me right now, but he is an absolute demon while Gamora is playing, but he will sell you a house while Gamora is not playing.
And he will haunt the house after he sold it to you and until Gamora is playing. Not a bad racket. Or maybe, yeah, then you can exercise. Yeah, I can see a vicious circle here going
yes.
on. Yeah. But anyway, yeah, so, yeah, Son of Satan, Tomb of Dracula, The Demon, Swamp Thing. And, of course, you know, DC came up with Swamp Thing, so Marvel came up with Man Thing.
Pretty cool character. Not as cool as Swamp Thing, but still cool.
Right, that's because he had almost no brain.
Yeah, Man Thing, the movie, that
terrible.
Movie sucks. That I can't get through that thing.
Terrible, because they just didn't, when they were making the movie, they were, see, even when Marvel came up with the series, first few issues, great. It debuted in Fear Comics. The only problem was they painted themselves into the proverbial corner, because the idea was that a human being experimenting with a strange new chemical formula fell into the swamp, turned into the Man Thing, but he was defined right from the start as nearly brainless. In other words, completely made out of slime, so which was great, because if you shot him or stabbed him or swung
it.
An axe at him, it just went right through him. And then he did his thing when he got his hands on you. So that was great. Except they made a big point of the fact that he was pretty much mindless and just reflected the emotions of the people around him.
Yeah, if you want to check out some decent books, and you're going to laugh at this, especially Tony, there are some pairing ups with Howard the Duck and Man Thing.
Oh.
That I remember reading those back in the day.
Those are hysterically funny. You got the guy that has no brain with the one that's like... really
the
out
sarcastic
there.
Mouth.
Doesn't yeah. Man Thing go back to your original subject? And the guy who has no brain goes back to your original you know, subject about politicians.
Yeah, he'd make a better politician than, yeah, definitely.
They'd be the perfect tag team for president. Now, Brainless and Big Mouth.
You did miss one DC horror character.
Okay.
Frankenstein. Had his own DC line of books, and they just rebooted him.
That's true, yes. I do remember that now. And I remember reading, as a matter of fact, I've read some issues of the original series.
And then you have, was it Ghost Man? Really cool.
Yep. Oh, and speaking of DC, the Phantom Stranger.
Oh, yeah, Phantom Stranger.
And when you mentioned, Frankenstein, and one of the greatest issues of a horror-themed comic ever was when the Phantom Stranger met Frankenstein's monster. It was a great spin on the Frankenstein story.
I'll tell you, if you're not a fan of Phantom Stranger, what's wrong with you? I mean, this book touches on so much stuff you're not supposed to. Even now, like, they're pulling in stuff there where people are afraid to talk about this stuff. The guy is the wandering Jew that killed Jesus Christ. That in his own should say, "Whoa,
it's a powerful statement.
I got to read this." I really like Phantom Stranger. I gave you the ghost one, and
now he was the one, he killed Jesus, or he betrayed Christ. Was he?
He was the one that he betrayed him and ended up getting him put on the cross. He was kind of like,
so that was Judas that.
Yeah, okay. I mean, really, really cool. And then you got Jonah Hex is still a horror character. The guy conversates. I mean,
he looks dead. He looks horrible. And yeah. Okay, yeah. You're right.
I mean, that's he's horror. Gonna have some sort I mean, he's got magic powers. Where he's communicating with stuff that's been in the ground.
Right.
No, he's definitely a horror character, and that's a strong one. So poorly done movie. I think they could have done better. I mean, I liked it.
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't unwatchable. I mean, it was watchable.
It was decent enough, but could have been better.
I mean, the whole thing with Megan Fox being the only one that had pearly whites
in that whole movie. Yeah, that was kind of ridiculous.
She was the only one that took baths in that whole movie, and she's supposed to be a prostitute.
She should have been a lot grimier looking.
Well, those white teeth, that's like almost a horror subject in itself. I mean, you know, the curse, you know, the ghost with the white teeth, you know, when Megan, you know, like, you know, 100 years after Megan is in the ground, her teeth will still be shiny and white.
Oh, my goodness. I don't know how much bleach that woman has used in her mouth, but.
And, of course, you have the ever so popular Solomon Grundy, who is definitely a horror character. Yeah,
never one of my favorites, though. Never.
No?
Not really, no.
I mean, I always liked him.
Isn't he kind of like the Walking Dead? He's like a walking zombie.
He's a walking zombie. You can't kill him.
But can't he hold an intelligent conversation?
He can hold an intelligent conversation.
Does it depend on the storyline?
He has super strength. I mean, it's not totally intelligent. It's kind of like Bizarro's. Like, he can still say, like, Solomon Grundy, want to smash you. And you can reason with him somewhat.
Kind of like the Hulk.
Yeah.
Which is maybe why I didn't, like, really take to him much, because I kind of thought it was a Hulk spinoff.
That'd be a good versus.
I
wonder if that's out there. I got to check that. Solomon Grundy versus Hulk.
Speaking of zombies, though, I remember Marvel went in the 70s, put out a black and white, you know, magazine size comic called Tales of the Zombie.
Good.
Starring
books.
A fellow named Simon Garth.
Yeah. Who picked up George Romero's series? Who did that? Because George Romero had Return of the Living Dead. Or not. He had his Night of the Living Dead series. And then there's Return of the Living Dead comic books, which those are really good. Who published George Romero's?
Nurse Misery is looking it up as we speak, I think.
Oh, I was actually looking up Hulk versus Grundy, but I can open up another tab.
Was there actually a Hulk met Solomon Grundy?
It looks like it's chatter. I'm trying to find a proper link to some sort of information. There's some YouTube videos that fans have made.
Yeah, kind of like Godzilla versus Gamera.
So it hasn't happened yet.
Yeah.
Yeah, not that I can find. It's mostly like fan page chatter and homemade movies kind of stuff. Nothing screaming.
All right. Okay. So while you're looking up Solomon Grundy, let's go back to the music. In honor of Solomon Grundy, let's do some Ramones. Ape Man Hop here on the Haunted Cabaret, Rhode Island Free Radio. Sugawi, Uga Buga, Matsuwana, Sumbunga, Buana Buana, Watsuwana, Yogi, Umbata, Konjuju, Konmona, Kalabanga, Ungawa.
He's got so many problems, you can count them one by one. He's a filthy, stupid ape man. He never has any fun. He lives in the jungle. make the face of a demon. Glowing by the firelight, hopping light, and a bit thunder and lightning tonight. He's the world's first witch doctor. The Iceman comes to life. He's the devil's apprentice. He's a prehistoric man.
All right, that was the Ramones' eight-man hop. 2 minutes and 4 seconds, according to Tony Jones, to tell the harrowing story of the issues and travails of a prehistoric man who cuts out his girlfriend's heart on a sacrificial altar and eats it.
Yeah, that song was based on a true story.
I replayed many times over, I'm sure, back in those days.
And that sounds like a comic book character, Vandal Savage, who's always killing Hawk Girl and Hawkman. For immortal life.
See, everything ties in. Everything ties in.
Yeah.
It really
does. That worked really well.
Right. I mean, okay. Actually, the last note, I don't know how this would tie in. Because my last note on this page here, because I usually just pretty much, I don't want to say I wing it, right? That sounds unprofessional. But usually we just go with, see where things go.
Well, what you told me is scripts are for weenies. So I stopped writing. Those weren't the words, but I stopped writing scripts because of that.
And you've been doing better ever since.
Yep.
Well, this week I defied my own advice, and I didn't write a script per se, but I just wrote topics. And I think, and amazingly enough, we've hit on all of them except one. Now, I don't know how I'm supposed to work this one in the last 5 minutes. But what I did is, because I'm always looking for things to occupy my mind on third shift, where I work to make some pay the bills money, I read Shakespeare's King Lear and Shakespeare's Macbeth.
Good now, book.
Ain't it? Now, yeah. I'm not... Yeah, I mean, what the hell? Horror is... We're the home of all things horror. Macbeth is a quintessential, and I don't care what literary professors and snobs say about it. It's a friggin' horror story.
Oh, it is.
All the way.
It's full of murder. It contains...
Ghost witches.
Hecate the demon. It's got everything.
Yeah.
That's that book right there.
So many nightmares.
Helped me pass high school because once I found out what they were saying in old English, I'm like, holy crap!
Right, you have to.
This is a horror movie on paper.
You have to get by that. No question about it. I mean, it's not language. You can just read it once.
It is difficult. I mean, especially...
But once you do, it's kind of like listening to the lyrics of a song you're trying to make out. And you know what I'm saying? And you listen to it and listen to it. And then once you do...
Yeah, once you get through like the first act or two, you're golden.
Then it's good to go. Yeah. But yeah, one of my favorite horror stories, Macbeth. And I couldn't help thinking about... See, just to bring it topical... Lady Macbeth and Macbeth, Hillary Clinton and Bill Clinton. I mean, honest to God, they say that Shakespeare, right, he talked about human, he knew really insight.
Human nature.
Knew human nature inside and out, right? Not really. All you have to know is that humans are basically evil.
Yeah.
That's the message of Macbeth. Everyone's evil. Some are more evil than others. Yeah. And if you're not evil yet, you will be by the time these witches and Satan get through with you.
Yeah.
So, I mean... My kind of message. So, yes, I did see, rereading Macbeth on the night shift, I did see a very big resemblance between Lady Macbeth and Macbeth and Hillary and Bill Clinton. No question about it. Just, profile those personalities. And then I read King Lear, too. Ever read King Lear?
I have. I vaguely remember parts of that one. That one didn't impress me as much as, of course, the ever-so-popular Hamlet and... Right.
Reading King Lear, though, and I tried reading it once, and it didn't do much for me. But then again, it's right in my book next to Macbeth. So I finished Macbeth and then started reading that again because it was in the book next to it. And it's about a king with three daughters. And he split, you know, he's retiring, so he splits his kingdom up among three daughters, and they're very ungrateful. And, you know, they go out of their way to get him killed and all kinds of great stuff. And he goes crazy. And all I could think of was Donald Trump with his three kids. I said to myself, see, my mind cross-references in weird ways. All I could think of was Donald Trump as King Lear dividing the Trump organization, because they make you give up your business once you become president. So he gives up his Trump organization. He's got three older kids, one younger, but that kid's too young.
Yeah.
So he's got three older kids. All I could picture was dividing up the Trump organization among his three kids. And, you know, then he gets impeached from president because he's a maniac. You know, goes back to his kids. They throw him out in the woods.
Because they're not going to let him back in.
They're not going to let him back in. And then they fight
and he becomes part of Rhode Island Free Radio. The next.
I couldn't have come up with a better finish.
We have a home for you here, Donald.
We do.
It'll be huge.
When your family doesn't love you, you don't have to run across the moors with flowers in your hair like King Lear. You can come to the Haunted Cabaret and Rhode Island Free Radio and make yourself a home.
Just as long as you don't try to bring the company public, because we all know what's going to happen if that's the case.
Yes. Go well.
Yes, you are not going to pump and dump Rhode Island Free Radio. You're just not going to do it.
Now, I'm monitoring the news here.
It quick, Tony. We want to get to the last song.
As I kind of always do. And surprisingly, and I can't believe it, 14 years ago today is when we lost Owen Hart.
Wow. Oh,
now, here's another one that I thought would be specifically of interest to the Haunted Cabaret.
Okay.
In a suicide attempt today in Chile, a guy stripped naked and jumped into a lion enclosure and then started swinging at the lions. He had a, you know... They found out that was the case. It wasn't just typical mental illness because he had a suicide note.
Right, he was trying to commit himself, suicide by lion.
That has to be the most creative suicide attempt I have. Now, the guy's still alive, so he was already suicidal, and now he's going to wake up realizing he can't do anything right.
But yeah, because I think I saw that on YouTube. The guy had his limbs ripped off. And,
well, the thing
so
to
did
me,
the lion savage him, or did they just stay away?
Yeah. The lion started to maul. He got naked, he got in the cage, and he started swinging at the lion. So I think probably if he just got in the cage, maybe,
they probably would,
you know,
not because
but yeah, he went
lions,
after the lions, so they did maul. And unfortunately, the zookeepers, they say they didn't have any fast-acting tranquilizers, so they had to kill the male and the female lion, and then they saved the guy.
Hey, it's not worth it. The lions are more valuable.
Exactly.
I'll tell you, yeah, he must, I don't know, maybe he was a student of Roman history or something, right? The Christians versus the lions?
You know, I was thinking, you know, as a student myself of theology, that is, there's so many things going on in that suicide attempt. And I mean, the fact that the guy lived.
Yeah,
you know what? We should have started that earlier in the show because we're almost out of time now. But I don't know, maybe the next show, remind me about that. We'll start off with, let's just say, unfortunate encounters between human beings and large cats.
That's a whole show in itself.
That's a whole show in itself. Yeah, we'll go back to the Roman Colosseum, one of my favorite places in a previous life. For now, though, let's go back. Let's get out of here. Let's go with Judas Priest, Nightcrawler, from the Painkiller album, my favorite Judas Priest album, here on the Haunted Cabaret on Rhode Island Free Radio. Nighty night.